this gladness. And so we're entering into this. And you might say, well, I'm in a struggle. I'm in a challenge. And God understands. And what we do by giving thanks is we posture our heart to receive from Him. And it takes our eyes off of ourselves, sets them on to Him, and we are then ready in a posture to be able to take in what He has for us this morning, each and every one of us. So what I want you to do is just, if you need to close your eyes so you're not distracted, just do whatever you need to do and just begin to give thanks. And the volume of your voice is not the issue. It's just the engagement of your heart of beginning to say, Jesus, thank you. Thank you. And if you need some help, there's a big cross behind me. Just meditate on the cross this morning. Jesus, thank you for the cross. And so I'm just going to lead us out, church. And let's just begin to roll out the red carpet for the worthy one this morning. His name is Jesus, and He's here in our midst. And so, Jesus, we just look to You this morning, and we say thank You, thank You, thank You, thank You, thank You for the cross, Jesus. Thank You that You demonstrate Your love for us. And You spread Your arms wide. That You left, You gladly left heaven to come and rescue us. And we say thank You. Thank You. Thank You for Your new mercies this morning, Jesus. Thank You. Thank You. Thank You. Thank You. We're just rolling out the red carpet, church, for Jesus. We're laying down our palm branches of thanksgiving this morning just to make a way for Him to come. We want You, Jesus. We just say thank You for You. Thank You that You are who You say You are. Thank You that You don't exaggerate. We can trust You. Thank You that You don't manipulate. We can trust You. Thank You that You are gracious and kind. Lord, thank You that You're a sympathetic high priest. Thank You, thank You, thank You. Thank You, thank You, thank You. Thank You, thank You for the cross, Jesus. Thank You for the crown of thorns that You endured, Lord. Thank You for the scourging, Lord, that You took upon Yourself so we could know You. Be Your sons and daughters. Thank You, 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 Lord. We say thank You this morning. Thank You, thank You. All eternity won't be enough time to give You the praise that's worthy. You're the worthy one. And we just say this morning, let the Lamb that was slain receive the reward of His sufferings. Jesus. You're the worthy one. We've found none more worthy. We've found the one in whom our soul delights. We choose to bless You this morning, Lord. We just want to bless You. 60 more seconds, church, of just exercising this muscle of thanksgiving. It's our heart aimed at Him, open wide before Him.
complicated. We're not going to sing about you today like you're not in this room. We're not going to talk about you like a person that we don't know. We're going to talk with you. We're going to sing to you. We're going to make eye contact with you this morning, Jesus. Whoa. So closer than our skin. This feels sacrifice. Let me dedicate my life to you. Time, let this be a sacrifice. Oh, let this be a sacrifice. Let me dedicate my life to worship you. Yeah. Let this be a sacrifice. Let me dedicate my life to you. I'm a lover of your presence.
Yeah.
Won't you let me dedicate my life? Let this be a sacrifice. Worship you. Ooh. We love you, Jesus. Oh, oh, oh. All the nations, they will come, holding broken chains above their eyes, singing we have overcome by the light of the Lamb. And all the nations, they will crown, holding broken chains above their eyes. Burn. satisfied. We won't be okay till every nation knows your name, Jesus. It's not okay. Every tribe knows you, Lord. It's not okay. Tell every language worships your name. Worships your name. Oh, Jesus is Lord over every name. You deserve our praise. Parts of your heart that will never, that were designed only to be worshipped and urdu, and those parts are so empty, God. There's parts of your heart that were only meant to be worshipped by the Chinese, God, and those parts are so, like, God, we just say that it's not okay until all of the Chinese can know you and have the opportunity to worship you, God. It's not okay. There's only parts, God, that the Native American tribes can reach inside of you to move you. And we say it's not okay until they know you, God. It's not okay. You're not satisfied, Jesus. You're not satisfied. We can't be satisfied as your church, Jesus, until every tribe, every tongue knows that you are Lord. And all the nations, they will come, all in broken chains above their heads, singing, we all the nations, they will come, holy broken chains above their heads, singing, we have overcome by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus, yours and you are mine. I don't want anything else. You are my one thing. You are my one thing. I don't want anyone else. I don't need anything else.
Take us into that one thing chorus. That was fire.
And I don't want anyone else. I don't need anything else. You are my one. You are my one. I don't want anyone else.
That's not true. Just declare it. Prophesy it. Places where we've flirted with lesser lovers, God. We're sorry. Because we just want you. We thank you that you're so gracious with us to pursue our heart. Jesus, thank you. Thank you that it's your love that captures our heart. It's not our commitment that makes us love you more. It's your love for us. So this morning, if there's other things in your life that are pulling your love away from him, just by faith, receive a greater measure of his love this morning. That's what's going to help you love him. Not because you get all your ducks in a row and get your act together. But let him love you this morning. Even your broken response of love pleases him. He draws pleasure from even our weak response. He has sympathy towards our struggle. So don't be condemned, but come boldly before him. Like a kid who's been caught with your hand in the cookie jar. Like, you're busted. Just, man, I'm sorry, but those cookies are so good. But God, if you'll capture my heart, I know with my theology that you're better, but my reality is today I want that cookie. Would you help me? Would you give me a greater measure of your love today that would change me? Help us, Jesus, to love you with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all of our strength. We know your love is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. So, Holy Spirit, would you shed abroad this morning? Give us more love. Let us become love and not grope around for it. Let us become this thing. Help us, Lord. We need your help. I want to just confess to just help all of us that it's a journey of Jesus becoming our one thing. And last year, in years, I mean, there was times for me where if I expressed what was really in my heart, then I would say, Jesus, you're my one thing plus ministry. Or times where, you know, Jesus, you're my one thing plus an awesome wife. You're my one thing plus give me some kids, you know. And it's so easy to just keep trying to tack things on. And it doesn't mean Jesus, obviously Jesus is for marriage, he's for kids, he's for all those things. But sometimes we use Jesus as a means to get those things, you know. Jesus plus, you know, a career. Jesus plus the blessings of this house or this whatever. But he truly is our exceedingly great reward. And when he is, those other things, you actually enjoy them more anyway, because they don't have a hold on your soul and your heart. And you're free to just love him and be loved by him. And so I'm just going to pray for us one more time, because all of us have those other little areas that are just competing for our affections, competing for our devotion. And so, Lord, I pray there be no condemnation in here this morning, because you don't condemn us. Even in the middle of getting caught with someone or something else, you don't condemn us. You invite us to cast that thing away from us and to cling to you, because you know that the best thing you could give us is yourself. So if there is anything in your life this morning, you have this beautiful gift called repentance. You just say, Jesus, I'm sorry. I want to want you. I keep turning to this other thing. Help me, Jesus. Amen. You know, you don't have to feel goosebumps for God to be helping you. You don't have to feel a thing when you prayed that prayer. You can be seated. We're going to receive communion together this morning, and we're also going to receive the offering. It was interesting last week. It was kind of spontaneous, and I had a lot of people say to me how impactful it was for them when we said, "Hey, we're not going to take up an offering. because Jesus doesn't take anything from us, and we as a church don't want to take anything from you either. But an offering is something you bring. You bring it to the Lord out of love for Him and response to Him. So as when you come up to get your elements, your communion elements, I'm going to ask you to hold on to those. We're going to take communion together. And if you have an offering, an in-person offering that you want to bring, you can put it in a basket on either side of these beautiful men of God up here. So the baskets are on each side, and then they'll give you guys the communion elements. But let me just pray over this offering. So Jesus, thank you that you're worthy of any offering we could bring. And so what we bring this morning, we bring as an act of worship. And we thank you this morning for your grace. And we ask for your blessing over this offering. I thank you for it. And I pray that, Lord, what's given will ultimately, because of your blessing upon it, will touch the nations, including our own, including our 10-block radius, including Galveston County, but not excluding the nations of the earth that you care about, Lord. So, Lord, let it multiply. In Jesus' name, amen. You may go ahead and stand up and come forward, get your communion elements. If you have an in-person offering, bring that at the same time. Hold on to the elements, go back to your seat, and we'll take it together. All right, I'm going to read just out of 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. And I want to let you know that I believe that God is doing something in light of communion, bringing revelation, bringing understanding to communion that I'll admit to you that I'm in the middle of. And I can simply say this right now, that this is more than symbolic, what we're doing this morning. I'm not going to try to declare theology this morning, but I do want to say to you, don't just do this morning as a ritual. And I'm going to read to us just a little bit of what we have here at 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. And there's a soberness and a sacredness to communion that I believe the Lord wants to restore back to the body. And I believe that there's something here of his presence than we've probably given more credit to. And Paul talks about this. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord." And here's where a sobriety comes. "Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world." This is intense. And this is around the table that Paul is giving us this instruction. And so I want to just, in simplicity, say, I want you to take your bread here. And discerning the body is the body of Jesus and the body, the community. And I want you right now to just ask the Lord, is there anything in your heart between you and him that needs to be addressed before you receive communion? And is there anything between you and another person in the body of Christ? Obviously, you can't get up and run and take care of that, but you can commit to the Lord that you will and you want to bring restoration to broken relationships. It matters to Jesus. And we're even instructed that even if you know someone has something against you, leave your gift at the altar and go restore that relationship. And there are times that we make an effort and we just do our part and leave the rest in the hands of God. But there's a sobriety here that this matters and that we're participating in the presence of the Lord, that there's something upon this sacrament. It's sacred. It's something he wants to restore. And there's a mystery to this we have to just acknowledge. But we're remembering, first and foremost, what Jesus has done for us. And the price that was paid on the cross. So right now, just you and Holy Spirit, just take about 30 seconds and just sit before him, ask him if there's anything, anyone. And if there is, before you receive communion, would you commit to restore those relationships, to begin the process? If there's any brokenness, unforgiveness, any sin. Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you made a way for restoration between us and you and us and our brothers and sisters. We ask for forgiveness this morning where it's needed. Let me just let you know, the Holy Spirit is very specific. So you don't have to just jump under a dark cloud if there's not something to apologize for, to repent of. But if there is, then let's deal with it now. And Lord, because we love you, we're committed to restoration in our earthly relationships. How could we say we love you who we can't see and we hate our brother or sister who we can see? We're a liar. If we're saying those things, if we're living that way, we're living a lie in that area of our life, and you want to bring life and wholeness and truth to our hearts this morning and set us free. And so by your grace, we say we will work toward restoration of relationships, toward forgiveness, toward releasing others that have sinned against us, and to asking for forgiveness to those who we've sinned against. We are committed to that, Jesus, because we love you. Receive it. Take your cup. In Revelation, we see this picture of Jesus standing at a door and knocking. And he says, knocking, and if you would open the door, I'll come in and sup with you. And it was this picture of the culture. The Jewish culture is that when a man wants to marry a woman, he goes with his father to the bride-to-be's house. They settle on a bride price. And not to buy her off, by the way, but to express her value and to honor the family and to it was part of the culture that they settled on a bride price. And then he had a cup, and it was called a betrothal cup. And if he stood at the door and knocked and she didn't answer, it was the equivalent of her saying, no, I don't want to be yours. And Jesus was saying, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And he was talking to the church. He wasn't talking to those that didn't know him. He was talking to those that know him and expressing that he wants more than just a token devotion. He wants the commitment that we would understand as equivalent to marriage. And we're given that picture of marriage so we can understand his commitment to us. And the devotion and the singleness of it, of his love for us. Well, the bridegroom would take the cup, and if she received the cup, it would seal their covenant together, and they would be there. They called it an engagement, but it was a binding agreement that would have to be. They'd have to go through divorce to get that agreement broken. And so Jesus says to us, he decides on the bride price, and it's the cross. And he offers us the cup, and it's his blood, and it's the seal. If we say yes to him, it seals this covenant. He does all of the work. He's the price. He's the covenant. He's the sacrifice. And if we say yes to him, it seals our covenant with him. Then what the bridegroom would do, if she said yes and they drank the cup together, is he would go back and prepare a place for her to come back and get her to be with him. Jesus left to prepare a place for you, and he's coming back to get you to be with him. And he's coming back for a bride, a ready bride. This is us. So Jesus, thank you for the cup of your love, the cup of covenant, covenant love. And we can be confident in this covenant because you did all the work, and it's not dependent on our commitment to you, but your commitment to us. And we jump into this covenant with all of our heart. And we thank you that you made a way for us to be forgiven, restored, cleansed, made new, prepared, a ready bride. You prepared us and you're preparing us. And so we just say yes. Receive.
crushing in the presence. You are making new eyes in the soul.
This morning, you know what? You're doing a very good work. And we trust you. We trust you in the dark seasons. We trust you in the mountaintops and the valleys. We trust you when we're beside still waters, and we trust you when we're in green pastures, and we trust you when we're in the valley of the shadow of death. We choose to trust you. Amen. Well, guys, we have something special in store for you this morning. We flew Grant Billings all the way from Dubai. We hold no expense back to get you the best. Now, he is from Dubai, and I'm going to let Topher has a strong relationship with Grant, and these guys go back to Dubai. But I just wanted to say this before I let Topher introduce Grant, is that God is doing something in connecting the heart of this house to Dubai and that region. And I want you just to begin to just kind of be open to that. Now, whether that may mean for some of you that you go long term, that you go short term, that I think for all of us it'll mean that we pray and we give and we go at some level, some way. But God's beginning to sow those things into our heart. And so, Topher, take it away.
How's it going, guys? It is my absolute pleasure and greatest honor. There's this scripture. I don't remember exactly how it goes. I'm sure some of you could shout it out. But basically, like, men of God, they have these treasures, new and old, right? They have, like, these in their house. They have stored up inside of the Word of God treasures, new and old, that they get to, whenever people come over, they sort of, like, share, you know, the finest things of the wealth they've maybe accumulated, or things that talk about their status. Well, guys, I'm so excited to introduce you guys to Grant Billings. This guy's an absolute treasure. You can come on up if you'd like. This guy has been laboring for how many years now?
8 years in ministry, 6 in Dubai.
All right. He's been 8 years of ministry, 6 years in the Middle East, just initiating prayer movement in the place where prayer has been dry and absent for centuries. And he's been out sharing the gospel and seeing movements happening amongst the poorest of the poor. And so this guy is my roommate of 3 years. This is the guy you go to for all the embarrassing Topher stories. But I'm just really thankful. So I'm just going to pray over him. He's a prayer guy, so he'll probably pray a couple more times during this time, too. So, God, I thank you for just dripping out over our community the oil of the anointing of men of God who have gone deep into the places of prayer, deep into the places of your heart, and mined the gold of the Spirit and handed out freely to everyone around them. God, we thank you for just coming up on a decade of Grant Billings loving you with all of his heart and serving you with everything that he has and laying down his crowns at your feet. And God, thank you that he came here today from the deep mines, the deep caves of your heart, to give us of the deep treasures that he has found there, God. We just say bless him, bless him, bless him, and that we would have his back in prayer, that this house would just own Grant Billings and the desires of God for him, and begin to, yeah, just continuously hold him up with our arms like Aaron held up the arms of Moses. And so we just say thank you, Lord. Grant, it's an honor to have you here, man.
Thank you. Thank you, Toph. Thank you very much. Wow, I'm really excited to be here. Just want to say thank you, first of all, to all y'all for having me here. I mean, people are like, who's this Grant Billings guy? I don't have a name. I'm nobody. So I just feel really welcomed. Thank you to Topher and to Robert and Beth and everybody who's kind of helped me just feel so welcome. I've loved being on the island. I've never been. If you're confused, someone said that I was from Dubai. People from Dubai don't talk like this. I'm from Alabama. People from Dubai talk like this. Okay, there we go. But yes, I have been serving the Lord there for 6 years, almost 6 years. And just very excited to be here. I'm excited to be in Galveston right now, because it really feels like the Lord is really doing something. And everybody that I've talked to, I am not from Texas originally, but my wife is, and her family's from like small town Texas. And I told them, yeah, I'm going down to Galveston to an Antioch church and to meet people from the House of Prayer. And they were like, in Galveston? What's going on? But it's like, come on, God is doing it. And all of you are a part of that. And so just pat on your back for just being a part of what God's doing. I have some slides, but don't worry, this is not one of those missionaries coming up and giving you a 30-minute slideshow. I'm really excited to talk this morning about what I think is the best topic ever. We get to talk about the greatest commandment. We get to talk about the first and second commandment this morning. But first, I'm going to show you all just a few things, and then I'm going to pray, and then we'll start. So this is our little family. That's my wife, Katie. It's our daughter, Levi, which there's a reason for that name. I'll share in a minute. And then that's our son, Thatcher. Yeah. Clap for her. Clap for Katie, because I didn't do anything difficult in any of that process, bringing them around. So they were not able to make the trip down to the island. Yeah, we'll go to the next picture. And so this is just a little bit of picture. Topher talked about ministry to the least and the last. In our city, the local Arabs are only about 10%, 60%. About 65% of the country are South Asians from India and Pakistan, and those guys make up the workforce, the labor force. A lot of those guys were, some guys were even trafficked in order to do certain jobs, and so the Lord has really given us a heart for these people, gave me a word back in 2017 that we were supposed to go to the slaves, the least and the lost, and so we learned Hindi and Urdu, and we're going in there, and I don't really have much composure right now because I ugly cried when Topher said that you deserve worship in Urdu. I mean, I ugly cried. Like, my whole body was heaving. I was sobbing. And so these are the guys that the Lord has kind of, allowed me to just be a part of the story of what he's doing. Then the next picture, this is our house of prayer. This is our Dubai house of prayer. That's one of my best friends, Barbara, up there, and that's kind of where I'll start going into what I feel like what the Lord is saying in this time. But I'm gonna pray really quick. God, I am so broken and needy for you, Lord. I have nothing to offer apart from you. I have literally nothing, God. So I just pray, Lord God, that this morning, nothing, God, this morning that, Lord, that the words that come out of my mouth would be straight from your Holy Spirit, God, that you would encourage our hearts, that you would stir us and give us a passion for the first commandment. Give us a passion this morning for the place of prayer. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that, God, as we listen to this, we wouldn't tune out, God, that I wouldn't just read the words, God, but we would really examine ourselves and say, God, would you help me to love you with my heart, mind, soul, and strength, every part of me, God. Lord, would you help us this morning in Jesus' name? Amen. So you can go back to my friend Barbara because I will start with a story. I remember when I first came to the Middle East having a spirited debate with my friend Barbara because we were having a debate on what's the reason that we do missions. Our team is sent out of a 24/7 house of prayer, but we were sent forward to do missions amongst the unreached of the world, a lot like Antioch. We're like connected best friends with the Antioch team there in Dubai. We had this big debate, and it was like, yeah, we were really going at each other, but it's good. and I was like, we do missions because there's people that don't know Jesus, and I need to share the gospel with them because they need to know Jesus. And she's like, no, Grant, we do missions because we love Jesus, and Jesus deserves to be worshipped. And we were going at it, and she was like, you will not be sustained if you just share the gospel so that people will get saved. I'm like, that's blasphemy. People need to get saved. And we were really going back and forth about it. And then she's like, okay, Grant, all right, let's go deeper in this. And she reminded me of the great quote that a lot of us know from John Piper, which is just so overused, but I still love it. He says, missions is not the ultimate goal of the church. Worship is. Missions exist because worship doesn't, right? We only do missions because the people that we are going to share with are not worshiping Jesus currently. That's why we do missions, right? That's it. Worship is ultimate, right? Missions, because missions, worship is ultimate, not missions, because God is the ultimate thing. God is the ultimate thing, not man. When this age is over and the countless millions of redeemed fall on their face before the throne of God, missions will be no more. It's true, right? It's a temporary necessity, but worship is eternal. And Psalm 22:27 says, all the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before you. Worship, they remember the Lord, and they turn to worship. It's the center of everything. And so my friend Barbara was right. So I just wanted to show her picture. She was right also because Jesus gives us the clearest picture of what's most important to God, right? When he's asked straight up, point blank. A lot of you probably know but where I'm going, but we're going to go into Matthew 22. So Jesus is, this is the next slide. Yeah, there you go. Jesus is in the temple, and they're trying to trick him, right? They're trying to trap him. They're like lobbing these pitches at Jesus, and he's just cranking them out of the park like Aaron Judge. He's just ka-kow! Like, he's just like, yeah, yeah, you think you got me? And then they're like, okay, hey, where's Steve? You know the lawyer? Steve? Go grab Steve. See what he's got. And Steve's like, all right, Jesus, get ready for this one. He's like, what's the greatest commandment of all, Jesus? Like, because Steve knows that they're all equally great. And Jesus' response is, Jesus, so it's brilliant. Jesus says to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. And then Jesus drops the mic. Yeah. So Jesus sums it all up. That this is what's most important. He quotes, actually, and I didn't know this until recently, but he quotes Deuteronomy 6, where it says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God. Your God is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. He's quoting that scripture that all Jews knew, and the guy said, yeah, you've answered correctly. And why is that important? Because Jesus makes a clear delineation there about what's supposed to come first and then what's supposed to come second. And for all of us, we tend to get this very mixed up even to this day, right? I come out of a 24/7 house of prayer, and I helped plant a house of prayer in the Middle East, and I get this mixed up every single day. So today what I'm going to do is we're going to kind of walk through the scripture a little bit, and we're going to explore what I believe are like four truths about putting the first commandment first, okay? So these are not on the slide, so if you want to take notes. If not, you got a good memory. All right, four truths about putting the first commandment first. So first thing, it's the only thing that will sustain us. There is not anything else, any other ministry opportunity, no amount of sharing the gospel with people that don't know Jesus that will sustain you. The only thing that will sustain you is putting Jesus in the first place in your life and having an intimate relationship with him. That's it. Number two, people will view what you do as a waste of time. That one's less sweet. People will look at you. If you truly put the first commandment first in your life, to the exclusion of other things, because that's what takes. When you put something first in your life, other things become second. When you do that, people will laugh at you, and people will think that you're wasting your time. That's a tougher truth. Number three, it is our ultimate calling as the church, as the body of Christ. It has been, and it is now. And then number four, walking in this calling will bring revival and joy to the nations. So praise God. Praise God. When we put the first things first, the nations will put the first things first. There will be worship in Urdu. There will be worship in Pashto. There will be worship in Arabic. There will be worship rising up out of these nations. Amen. Woo! I'm fired up. Okay, so let's Jesus, I love the way he answers this question, and he also answers it in Mark, and he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And as I was just considering this, I think one of the biggest problems that we have, that I have as a member of the body of Christ, and as someone who grew up in the church and has read this scripture before, is I think I read that, and I go, yeah, I get it, yeah, I love God. And it stops in my mind, right? Jesus says heart, soul, mind, and strength. But for most of us, where loving God begins and ends is in our mind. I know that I love God, and God loves me. Now, for those of you that are married, I want you to ask yourself, if your relationship with your wife was, I know that I love my wife, and my wife loves me, okay, see you later, I'm never going to spend time around you, how would that go, right? How would that go? Heart, soul, mind, and strength is a holistic, it's every part, every element of our life the first thing that we're supposed to do, our first priorities should be loving God. And for me, I can say on a daily basis, it probably isn't. I'm a huge Auburn football fan. I think sometimes much more of my heart, mind, soul, and strength is wrapped up in how bad we stink at playing football. And I spend my money on going to the games, or I buy tickets, or I do all these things. And I'm not only cognitively aware that I like Auburn football, but my soul is caught up in it, my heart is caught up, and my strength is used to support the team. Okay, that's kind of that's what heart, mind, soul, and strength means. But how often with Jesus are we that way? How often with Jesus are we that way? How often with Jesus are we like, yeah, I'd buy a plane ticket right now to go and just fly to a random house of prayer in Indonesia just to worship you in a place that you've never been worshiped? How often with Jesus are we like, yes, I know you, God, but I want to sit at your feet and I want to know your love for me. My soul longs for you. Like David says, my flesh, you know, thirsts for you. How often are we like that with Jesus? Can I get an amen? Amen. Oh, man. Oh, hallelujah. Yeah, we want to dip our toe in the first commandment. You're like, okay, that feels good. Now jump into the second commandment, because then that, like, because we want to feel like we're doing something, right? But the first commandment, I hate to break this to you, there's nothing that you can do to make the first commandment happen. There's nothing you can do to make the first commandment work. It is not on you in any way, shape, or form. The first commandment is loving God. Why? Because he first loved us, right? It is a posture that can only be achieved. It is in a commandment that can only be followed in a place of full surrender. And no one will ever look at you and think that you're doing a lot. No one will ever look at you and think that you're very successful, because it's not on you. And it's very clearly not on you, all right? So we want to dip our toe in, I know God loves me, and then we want to jump into the pool of second commandment. But even in the scripture, Jesus gives you a real clue to why that doesn't work. And then this is our kind of truth one, is that the first commandment is the only thing that will sustain us. Jesus says that the second is like it. And I read that, and I've been, like, meditating on that all week. Like, what do you mean the second is like it? And the Lord just, like, opened my eyes, and he's like, it's like it because in order to do the second commandment in the same way that the first commandment works, you can only love others if you know that you're loved by God, right? We love because God first loves us. So first commandment, we love God because we know God first loved us. Right? In order to do the second commandment, you need the same formula. You need to know that God has first loved you. But if you've never spent time with God, how do you know that he loves you? If you just skipped first commandment and you said, I'm not going to spend time with you first, I'm not going to exalt you first, I'm not going to put you first in my life, I'm just going to do stuff for you, God, because I do love you. I know in my brain I love you. You're going to walk into that next thing and you can't give out an ounce of love. You can give out an ounce of work, but you can't get out an ounce of love. You can polish up that work real good, and so the person, you think that you're giving love, but you're not giving love. Because no matter how hard you squeeze, no matter how hard you strain, you're not going to push out any love. You're not going to push out any fruit. The formula, the math does not work. Am I right, Mr. V? The math just does not work. It just doesn't work. We need God to love God. And we need God to love others. Whew, okay. That's the next. I just skipped the slide, but that was the next slide, is we love because we first loved us. You can go two ahead. So that kind of brings us to our next truth. Like, and this is our inconvenient truth, right? Our awesome truth is like, wow, putting the first commandment first, setting aside as the thing that can never be moved, my time with Jesus is actually going to help me love other people. That's a really, really fun, awesome truth, because we want to love our neighbors. We want to love them as ourselves. It's the second commandment. We want to do it. But then we come to the next truth, and that truth is a lot harder to swallow sometimes, and that's that people will, if you choose to actually do this, people will view your life as a waste. People will talk. People will say, and I've had it said about me. And I've had it said to me. And there are biblical examples. We'll go to the next slide. And the ones that stand out the most to me are the stories of, let's see, the next slide. Yes, there we go. Is the story of the stories of Mary of Bethany, and I think this is one of them. We're sure is Mary of Bethany, and the other one it's speculated it is. And but so I'll just read it. You can read it too. But and when Jesus was in Bethany, so he's eating in his friend's house. This is right before his death, at the house of Simon the leper. A woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor." But when Jesus was aware of it, he said to them, "Why do you trouble this woman? For she has done a good work for me. For you will have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her." Amen. Amen. So this woman, Jesus is at a party. He's sitting with his friends, and this woman, out of just her affection and love for Jesus, anoints his body with this flask of oil. And I remember as a kid, and even as an early Christian, reading this and being like, did he just like go to HEB and just get like a tub of olive oil and just like pour it all over? Like, I was so confused until somebody explained that in ancient Judea, you know, these oils, these perfumed oils were of incredible, immense worth and value. And that probably most likely that bottle of oil was her bride, her dowry. That was her security. That was her future. That was her everything. And what did she do? She broke it at the feet of Jesus. She said, "Jesus, I love you so much. And you're so beautiful that I'm breaking my life, my future, my everything, and I'm pouring it out." And people looked at her and didn't say, the disciples, these are people who've been following Jesus for 3 years, right? They knew Jesus the most. They knew all of the parables. Like, hey, you remember last week when Jesus said this parable? That was their life. And they looked at her and they were like, why are you wasting this on him? Why are you wasting this? Why are you wasting this? The human response of, you just poured $30,000 on the floor just because you love this man? Like, they're poor. What could we have done? These good intentions. What could we have done for the poor with this, right? That feels kind of right to the logical side of my brain. I don't know if any of you are honest. I see the disciples' point. And there are times that I find myself in judgment of my brothers taking the disciples' point of view, right? Why this waste? And Jesus says, the poor you will have with you always, but me you will not have always. He does two things. He responds, and he covers her, and then he honors her. He covers what she's doing. He says, she has done a good thing, right? She has done a good thing to waste her life just because of love on Jesus. That is it. First of all, Jesus is a good thing. And then he honors her for all time. And he says, wherever the gospel will be preached, this will be preached. This will be preached also as a memorial to her, right? And so Jesus cares so much about the first commandment that he will rebuke his best friends to say this is good, what she's doing. And not only that, wherever you go, you who are talking bad about her right now, you're going to tell it, and you're going to, because these are the guys that are going to make all the other disciples. You're going to tell your disciples, and they're going to tell your disciples, and you're going to tell your disciples. And if you don't like it, tough, because that's my kingdom, right? It's my kingdom. It's my kingdom. And the craziest thing, just what blows my mind, is the very next like section of Matthew chapter 26. Does anyone else know what that is? Judas leaves this dinner and he goes to the chief priests. He's so offended in his heart and it's so wasteful in his eyes that and he's so offended that he turns away from God. And I share this inconvenient, difficult truth because I'm telling you that there will be some in the church, the disciples, that do not understand if you choose to give up of your time, of your money, of your energy, of your everything to put the first commandment first place in your life. And that's a biblical reality. That's something that happened. And so, and it's like the story of Mary and Martha. I mean, Jesus says to Martha, she's chosen the better part and it will not be taken away from her. So people will get offended, people will get mad, but Jesus is like, but I'm going to protect it. I'm going to cover it, and it's not going to be taken away from you. So that's the great news. And the Bible tells us, and we'll go into point three, that it is going to be, and it is our ultimate calling of the church, is to minister to the Lord, to put the first commandment in first place. 1 Peter 2:9 says, calls us a priesthood, right? He says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Hallelujah. We're a kingdom. We have authority, but we're a kingdom of priests, right? Amen. You're a priest. You're a priest. Everybody's a priest. Everybody's. I thought that was funny. yeah, you're a priest. We're priests. And what does that mean? Does anybody else feel that way? What does that mean, God? Okay, I'm a priest. So to this Jewish audience that he's speaking to, a priest refers to just the priest in the temple of God, those that stand and minister to the Lord. And so in the Old Testament, that looked like the tribe of Levi. And I'm just going to read this. This is not up there. But Deuteronomy 10:8-9, at that time, the Lord separated the tribe of Levi to bear the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord and to stand before the Lord and to minister to him and bless in his name to this day. Therefore, Levi has no portion nor inheritance with his brethren, but the Lord is his inheritance, just as the Lord your God promised him. So that scripture is actually where we got our daughter's name from. The Lord gave me that name, and that night my wife found out that she was pregnant with our firstborn, and the Lord said, name your firstborn Levi if it's a boy or if it's a girl. Because for us who have given our lives, we've given up every birthday, we've given up every single holiday, weddings, friendships, family, to go to the ends of the earth to tell people about Jesus, but more than that, just to worship his name and call people into that, that our kids, they don't get to enjoy the family land. They don't get to enjoy the Lord as their inheritance. The Lord is their inheritance. So that's the name. And that's all of us, though. But that's what I want to say. The Lord gave me that word, but that's all of you. Y'all, we're moving into times that are getting a little spicy, a little bit shaky, right? Okay? I just want to say this, and this may bother us, but your children's inheritance, your children's children's inheritance may not look like the same as what you got, but guess what? The Lord will be their inheritance. Because why? Hallelujah, right? The Lord will be their inheritance because you are a kingdom of priests. You are the modern day Levites. You are a kingdom of priests. Peter says it right here in Peter. You're a chosen generation. We actually are chosen by God to be priests. To be a holy nation, we're chosen. We're chosen. And your inheritance, your family's inheritance will be the Lord. And that's a joyful thing. But it's not going to be that way if we don't actually show up to the job of being priests. Let me say that again. Your inheritance will be the Lord. Your children's inheritance will be the Lord no matter what happens. But if you don't show up to the job of being a priest, if you just say, yeah, that's not really for me, I don't really relate. And I'm not talking about going in, being in the house of prayer or even going to the nations. Everyone's looks different. But as the body of Christ, if we don't worship Jesus, even in our own homes, in our life groups, if we don't put it first and say, we will cancel other programs in order to pray and to worship Jesus, that's what priests do. If we don't do that, then we don't get the the other side, which is having an inheritance that comes from the Lord no matter what. No matter what. Whew. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. And so in the New Testament, they continue to minister to the Lord as a major part of their ministry. It says in Acts 13:2 that as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, "Separate to me now Barnabas and Saul for the work which I've called to them." It's not something that stopped in the Old Testament. It's something that we're still called to be now. We are called to be priests now. We're called to minister to the Lord now in our own special, unique way as Antioch Galveston, as our life groups, as our families, as the house of prayer here, as the house of prayer in Dubai. We're called. So it is our calling. And Ephesians 2:19-22, we're kind of just want to throw a lot of these scriptures at us just so it hits us down in our core that this is who we are. This is who we are as a church. Now, therefore, you're no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, and the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. We're not bound to have to go and worship in the temple in Jerusalem, but we are the stones of the new temple, right? We are built together with Jesus as the chief cornerstone. Each of our little life groups, each of our houses, each of our families, each of our churches, we are built together, right, into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom we're being built together as a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. And so that is a really amazing calling. It's the priestly calling, and it's your calling. And I want to say one thing about like temples and buildings, and I think a lot of us know that, but if we're all being built together as the temple, if some of us decide, that's not for me, there's going to be holes in that temple. There's going to be holes in that temple. There's going to be chunks missing. So each and every one of us is important. I don't care how old you are. I don't care where you're from or how long you've been in the Lord. You're part of the temple of God. And only together can we house and can we dwell, can the Spirit of God dwell amongst us, right? Amen. All right. So we'll go to the last slide now. I have Isaiah 56:6-7. And so walking in this calling will bring revival and joy to the nations. The foreigners who join themselves to the Lord to minister to him and to love the name of the Lord, even to those I will make them joyful in my house of prayer, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all people. So that's Isaiah 56:6-7. And so the end result of just us becoming the temple, of the Spirit of God dwelling in us, the Lord is going to bring all of the foreigners. He's going to bring people from abroad. They're going to join themselves to the Lord, and they're going to join together, minister to him, love the name of the Lord, and the Lord is going to just like pour out joy. And so the arc of our story, right, we know that even in our daily lives now, without putting the first commandment first, there's no way that we can love the world around us. There's no way that we can be sustained. If we choose to do that, we will have trouble. We will have struggle. People will not understand, but Jesus will cover us, and Jesus will honor us and increase what we're doing. Just from my own example, like I literally cut my work hours almost in half to say, I'm going to go spend it in the prayer room. There's a lot of other workers that do a lot more stuff than me, but the Lord has allowed me to learn language faster than each and every one of them. The Lord has increased the things that we're doing to we're seeing like 3 to 4 baptisms a month from North Indian Hindus that have never heard of the gospel, the name of Jesus. But that's not because I worked the most hours. I worked less ministry hours than all these people because I'm giving it to the Lord. So people will not understand, but the Lord will give you the increase. And then it is your calling. Each and every one of you are important in this. We cannot build the temple of God in Galveston, Texas. We cannot house the presence of God, be the dwelling place of God in Galveston, Texas without each and every one of you. You cannot be it in this nation without each and every one of you taking your spot. I mean, and whatever that looks like, but just even if it's as small as saying, this morning I'm just going to spend 15 minutes, and I'm just going to look at the beauty of Jesus, and I'm going to tell him that he's the Lord of Galveston, Texas. It can be that small. It can be taking a prayer set in the house of prayer. It can be going to the end of the nations, into the nations, and telling people about Jesus and inviting them not only to go and, you know, and believe on Jesus and read their Bible, but to a lifestyle of worship and beholding and putting God first and teaching their people that. It can be all of those things, but we know that the Lord has given us that promise, right? That the foreigners, all of the nations who join themselves to the Lord will join themselves to the Lord to minister to him and to love the name of the Lord. God has promised that all of these nations, he will make them joyful, right? He will make them joyful in the house of prayer. He says he's going to call his house a house of prayer for all nations. And so, God, I just thank you, Lord. I'm overwhelmed by the fact, God, that we get to be a part of this story, that we get to together come together as living stones with you as the cornerstone, God. And each of us get to do our part as being stones in the temple in our own way, our own expression of worship to you, of exalting you, of putting you in the first place in our life, God. God, we know that if we do that, if we all do that together, God, we will see the nations, God, come into a joy that they have never experienced before. God, we won't make disciples that are dry and that are brittle. We won't make disciples that are in it just for the money or for whatever they can get out of it, but we will make disciples that love you because they've seen us live it in our lives. They've seen us do it. They've seen us put the first commandment first. We want to make disciples. We want to see the nations, God, learn to love you because you first loved them, to love each other because you first loved them. So yeah, just the prayer team's going to come up, and if any of you have any prayer needs, if you want to just pray, like, I don't know what it looks like to surrender myself to loving God above all things, but I want to. I want to know. I want to try, but I need prayer. I need prayer to not be distracted. I need prayer to not be discouraged when people don't understand. If that's you, I just invite you to come get prayer. And if you have any ailments, anything else that you need prayer, just come get prayer for. Like we believe, we know that God answers prayers. That He wants to hear your voice. He wants you to love him right now, and he wants to love you back. So God, we just thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you that here in this room right now, we just love you with our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength from this house, from Galveston, Texas, in Jesus' name. Amen.
All the people, will sing your praises. All the people will sing your praises. All the people will sing your praises. Glory to the Lamb of God. All the people will sing your praises. All the people will sing your praises. All the people will sing your praises. Glory to the Lamb of God. Praises.
above their heads, singing, we have overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
Like, we just need to wait on the Lord for a moment. Grant did a great job in laying out the heart of God, and I feel like the Lord wants to, if there was a measurement of the worth of Jesus, that he wants to raise the value in our hearts this morning of the worth of Jesus. His worth. That's really what is the root of our worthship. It's how worthy is he to you? He wants to raise the barometer in our hearts, raise the temperature of his worth. Holy Spirit, if you will reveal Jesus to us in greater measures, that we could see the worth of Jesus, our lives will respond in worship by your grace, Lord. That's what we want. Oh, man. And I feel like they go hand in hand. He wants to raise the worth, and he does that as we give ourselves to him in all these postures that Grant talked about, and in coming before him and putting his, you know, meditating on his word and spending time in prayer. And it's, we give ourselves to those things, and God reveals himself in those things. So maybe just ask the Lord right now, what is your next step in being a part of this dwelling place in Galveston, Texas, wherever you are? What's it look like for you to be a priest? What's your next step of obedience to him? We trust, Holy Spirit, that you are forming and shaping and calling and inviting and wooing us to this place. And we just want to be obedient lovers. Amen. I'll have a few announcements for us before we dismiss. And just want to first of all say thank you to our guests. Man, thank you for doing the most difficult thing in this whole process of becoming a part of a church family, is coming to a new place. So, man, you did your part. We have some information we want to put in your hands. A gift for you, and a very pretty lady named Miss Pam back there that will, nicest person to talk to you this morning. So you want to go and connect with her at the table there. Okay. Hey, I'm doing something right now, man. What are you interrupting me? Sunday night tonight, we have prayer from 5 to 7. And our church leadership team has been waiting on the Lord and spending time in prayer to ask the Lord for our prayer targets for this house. And so we'll put these in your hands next week. But we have a slide up here that I wanted to just make this known to you, that we're saying, God, we're praying for different things, but what would you have us give ourselves to? And a team of us, we spent some time, a week or so, just waiting on God. And it was interesting as we all kind of like put down what we thought God was saying. It was all in line, you know, and it was all under these four main targets. And so we've put those for you. And again, we'll put these in your hands next week. But we'll be hitting some of this tonight in prayer. That's why I wanted to let you see that. And my phone will recalibrate here. I can give you the last one. Okay, yeah, this is important. Starting tomorrow, so Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, we're taking the first 3 days of each month. Let me remind you, we're in a 90-day journey that God is calling us to build out a house of prayer out of this community. And part of our commitment to that was to fast and to pray. And so Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday are days of fasting. There's a fasting guide in your bulletin that will help you, and that will culminate on Jesus night this Wednesday, okay, where all of our life groups pause and come together here in the prayer room. Last month was fire. It was the presence of Jesus makes all the difference, and he's the reason we're coming together. And that's a good reason. And so that'll be this Wednesday. And there is childcare. Give your life group leader a heads up so we can prepare for childcare. That's the most difficult aspect, because we don't want to ask any of you to do childcare. So we're really trying to reach outside of our community. So if you know someone that can help with childcare, we pay. Notice I didn't say good money. We pay, though. Okay? Pizza slices. No, we do pay in cash. So Topher. Topher is going to put the icing on this cake, and we're done.
Woo! No, I just want to say we're so thankful to have Grant here, and we're going to continuously cover him as a family, of course, in prayer, and him and his team. But, guys, he prepared a bunch of really beautiful prayer cards over there. The Billings prepared a really beautiful prayer card in the back on the Connect table. You'll see a black and white picture of he and his wife and their two children. Grab one, put it on your fridge, pray for them. That's all I want to say. Love you guys. Have a great Sunday.
faithfulness. I've seen miracles my mind can't comprehend. And there is beauty in what I can't understand. Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. I believe you're the wonder-working God. You're the wonder-working God. All the miracles I've seen, too good to not believe. You're the wonder-working God, and you heal because you love. All the miracles we'll see, you're too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Oh. And I can't resurrect a man with my own hands. Just the mention of your name can raise the dead. Yeah. All the glory to the only one who can. Jesus is here. Jesus is here.
Thank you.